Climax is the climax of this book. My Lord and my God. And you connect it to verse 31. Jesus is the Christ. He is the anointed one and the Son of God. In other words, He is the Messiah. He is the one appointed to be actually our prophet, our priest, and our king. And that's the purpose of this book. For us to recognize that this Lord Jesus Christ, whom we crucified, is indeed the Christ, prophet, priest, and king. He is someone whom we should look up to. He is the one whom we should listen to. He is the one whom we should submit to. And he is the one whom we should rely on for our sins to be forgiven. That he is the Christ. And he is also God. One collects everything possible about a dead prophet. It is all one has of him. But one only tells enough of a living person to introduce one's hearers to him. John trusts that a personal relationship with Jesus will reveal more to the believer. That's why in verse 30, it says, which are not written in this book. Why? Because the Lord Jesus Christ is not dead. He is alive. Because if the Lord Jesus Christ is dead and was not raised up from the dead, it's basically a bibliography. It's basically his life. And there's a conclusion. But because the Lord's life has no conclusion, because he is alive, we could not contain all what he has done in a single book. Because even now, you could still continue writing what the Lord is doing even in our age. Because we have to remember that even in this age and in this time, the Lord Jesus Christ is interceding in heaven on our behalf. When we are praying, it is the Lord who actually stands in our account. It is actually the Lord who tells God to actually listen to our prayers, especially if we pray according to His will. So, that's what the Lord is doing now. And we cannot contain them even if we write until now. We cannot even finish that book. The story goes on and on and on. And even the second coming, we still do not know. Now, let's talk now about the Lord's Day. It's emphasized here in John chapter 20, first day of the week, and then verse 19, first day of the week, and then 8 days after, in verse 26. All of them are referring to the resurrection day. Now, the 8 days after, if you're counting the day, you should include the day itself. So if you count 8 days after, so that includes today, so that means you have Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It falls again on a Sunday. So that means the 8 days after here refers to the Lord's Day. Now, you have to remember that John was writing this book in the island of Patmos. He was writing this book. Therefore, the word first day of the week is not merely a fresh incident. What I mean by fresh incident means it happened few days ago. It happened several years after, but the way he remembered it, it was actually the first day of the week. That's where actually the Lord's Day was established. Now, this first day of the week was actually connected to the Sabbath, because the Sabbath's purpose was actually to bless the creation. Especially the apex of the creation, the human race, is actually to give blessing. Now, the highest form of blessing was actually the resurrection of the Lord. That's why I was thinking that I know so little about the birth of Christ, so that's why I'm not eligible, or I find myself unworthy to preach about the birth of Christ. But I know that there's one event that is more significant than the incarnation of our Lord, and that is the resurrection of our Lord. Because Paul says in his epistle that if Jesus Christ was not raised up from the dead, then our faith will be useless. Our faith would be nothing if the Lord has not raised up from the dead. And he said, but Paul said, indeed, the Lord has risen. Now, because of that, the Lord himself shows up to the disciples on the first day of the week. Okay? That's his prerogative. And then, remember that between verse 24 and 26, the gap is actually 7 days. If you read in between verse 25 and verse 26, apparently the disciples are meeting every day. The disciples are meeting every day waiting for the Lord. However, the Lord himself chose to appear on the next Lord's Day. So what does that mean? The Lord then wants to establish a pattern of worship, a pattern where the disciples meet together as a church or as people of God. And that was established during the Lord's Day, during the first day of the week, and we call it Sunday. Okay? So, that's the establishment of the Lord's Day. Now, if you notice, there's a big difference between celebrating Sabbath day on a seventh day and celebrating the Sabbath day on the Lord's Day or on the first day of the week. So, that resembles the two covenants, the two different covenants in the scripture. So, first, the celebration of Sabbath on the Sabbath day or the seventh day of the week, you have to do 6 days of work first and then you rest in the Lord. So that means you're under the covenant of works. Because on the covenant of works, you have to work, you have to be obedient, you have to show complete obedience to God before you will be completely accepted by God. That's covenant of works. That's why you have to work first, earn your merit, and then rest in the Lord. And that's celebrating Sabbath day on a Saturday. Okay? However, we cannot do that. We are not obedient and we have completely disobeyed the Lord God in His commandment to be perfect as the Lord your God is perfect. We cannot do that. We cannot be perfect. And that's why we are hopeless in that covenant of works. Now, in the New Testament, in the new covenant, the day of the Lord himself has set up a pattern that we rest in the Lord first. That's the first day of the week. And then we work. And that is the covenant of grace. Because it's the Lord himself who initiated the rest period. To rest in the Lord. He himself initiated it by appearing on the first day of the week. Because the Lord Jesus Christ, if you think about it, the Lord Jesus Christ can actually appear on a different day, not first day of the week, not second day of the week, not third day of the week, so on and so forth. He can appear actually anytime, but he decided for a reason to appear on the first day of the week. He appeared on the first day of the week for a certain purpose, which is to remind the disciples, to remind us that we find rest in the Lord first. We find our salvation first because of God's prerogative, because of God's initiative. And then because we are now saved, we work. That's the essence of the Lord's Day on the first day of the week. Now, let's talk about church discipline. Because the passage says, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. We have to remember that, we have to remind ourselves that we don't have the authority to actually call someone sinner and to call someone not sinner or to call someone guiltless because we do not know the hearts of the people. We can only look at the outside. That's why there's a passage says, man looks at the outside, but God sees at the inside. And that's true because what we can only see and what we can only perceive is based on what we see on the outside. And that's true. Now, because of that, we cannot determine if one person is a sinner or if one person is not a sinner. We don't have the right to judge a person based on that, especially on our times right now. Okay? However, the church or the disciples were actually given authority to exercise church discipline. Now, when you exercise church discipline, of course, the basis is outside. So what they see on the outside and what are the physical evidences that you see on the outside before you can actually exercise that. Okay? It is necessary because Christ himself says so. Remember, it is the Christ, it is Jesus Christ who gave the disciples or the apostles the authority to exercise this. Second, the purpose of church discipline is for spiritual edification of all believers. Now, why is it so? Because in the church discipline, you are seeing first that God is God. In other words, God is the God who exercises discipline. You have to know that. That's why a church that is not strict is also a church that will eventually forsake God. Third, church discipline, the purpose of church discipline is for conformity to God. Remember that Christians were commanded to be conformed to God's standards. In Romans 12, verse 2, it says, Paul says there, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." It was written in a negative sense because Paul says there, "Do not be conformed to this world." So the question is, if you are not conformed to this world, then who should you be conforming yourselves to? And the only answer there is God, because it's God against the world. So you should conform yourselves to God. And one aspect of we being conformed to God is through the exercise of church discipline. Church discipline may sound legalistic. That's why we have to exercise this more carefully, and we have to exercise this with spiritual implications and basis. Okay? So when you say church discipline, it's not only about the negative aspect where one is being put away and one was devoid of fellowship. But the one good aspect of church discipline was when someone who is under church discipline will finally be restored. Because if that person is restored, you can see yourself being restored back to God from your ways of sin. And that is a reflection. Church discipline is a good reflection somehow of someone who is a sinner, who was a sinner and God proclaimed him guilty, and yet through God's prerogative, he was now restored and he became reconciled to God. So please do your best and please pray to God so that each one of us will be spiritually restored. So I ask everybody right now, please come to your senses. Okay? So in conclusion, based on this passage, we learn that faith is not something mystical, but it is something that we based on, let's say, on testimony of others, on good example of Thomas. It says here, Thomas is good example in many ways. He refused to say he understood when he didn't. He refused to pretend to believe when he didn't. And when he did understand and believe, he went all the way and properly called Jesus Lord and God. And that will be my conclusion for today's message. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we again thank you for your word. Thank you because you have reminded us that indeed, we are reconciled to you through your own prerogative, through your own initiative. We thank you because we are able to love you only because you have first loved us. Father, may you help us to share this message, to share this commission, and do our part in sharing your word, or in prayer, or in fellowship, that your kingdom may indeed expand and may indeed come. Father, we acknowledge that we are so stiff-necked people and we need constant reminders that we were once sinners and that we were only reconciled to you because of your grace. So Father, we thank you and we glorify your name because it is only by your grace that we are actually saved. Father, we also pray for those who are under church discipline in so many churches and in different aspects of the world. We pray, Father, that in your own time, that you would restore them, that you will speak to them, that you will edify them, that you will remind them the joys of your salvation. Father, we again thank you because Thomas is indeed, in a way, an example for us to learn that we should not rely merely on physical evidences, but we should rely on the testimonies, especially the Word of God. So, Father, please help us to dig deeper, to learn more about your Word so that we may be more convinced, that we may be more edified regarding our Lord Jesus Christ and Him crucified. So, Father, please bless the remaining of our time. For all of these things we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay.